This conference will now be recorded.
All right. So the mystery photo from Matthew Sturm of the day is about snowmobiles because he thinks anyone who studies snow should know something about snowmobiles. I'm really bad at snowmobiles, so I don't have any good hints. You guys are on your own here. These are his old, the yellow is the old one and the red is his new one because you couldn't tell. Snowmobiles, and he asks, what are five things different about these two snowmobiles? And how do they affect the snow? So think about it, and I'll give you the answer on Wednesday from Matthew, not from me. Okay, so I'm moving on to something I know more about than snowmobiles. The whole thing just disappeared. Come on, don't do that. All right, so this is related to homework one. And what you see here is, this is a picture of a picture. This is me out on the plains near Bozeman, Montana, holding my IR camera. And I'm pointing out the IR camera, looking at clouds, plains, some hills in the distance with trees on them, and some irrigation equipment in the foreground here. And what the color bars represent, this is it's an IR camera, so it is sensing long wave radiation. It is converting that to brightness temperature. The coldest thing is negative 30 C with a really dark blue, and the hottest thing is the white and kind of white pink at 7 degrees Celsius. So what, somebody tell me, what do you notice in this picture?
Clouds are warm.
The trees are warmest.
Anything interesting? Anything related to homework one, maybe?
The clouds are warm.
What's the coldest thing in the picture?
The clear sky.
Are you guys all muted? Do I need to do something?
Clear sky is the coldest.
Are you guys muted and can't unmute? Is that the problem? Let's see.
Clear skies are the coldest.
Yeah, I think I just muted you all. Okay, I think you should all be unmuted now. Try now.
The clouds are warm.
I can't hear you. Can you hear each other? Audio. Let's see. Audio. Output. Computer audio. Machine. I can't hear others. Yeah. So you guys can all hear me, right? Thumbs up. Can you hear each other? You can hear, you just can't, I just can't hear you. Okay. All right. That's the joys of this. Okay. Jessica can't hear us. Yep. Okay. All right. So I got chat. So on chat, give me an idea. I can try calling in, which probably is going to give you guys terrible feedback. All right, I will leave this on my computer audio, which for some reason today does not want to give me your sound. It did every other day. So trees are the warmest, the sky is the coldest, and the clouds are close to the same temperature as the snow. Yes, thank you for typing things in and helping me out here. So basically the sky, the clear sky is the coldest, and what you're seeing is that, you know, the infrared temperature is proportional to the long wave radiation emitted. So we get very little long wave from the clear sky. We're in Montana, it's pretty dry. There's not much water vapor. The water vapor is in the clouds. And so the clouds have a much higher emissivity, close to one, and are emitting long wave radiation proportionately. It's close to the snow. The trees are definitely the warmest thing in the picture. And so you can see they're close to the surface temperature. And so the trees in long wave are acting to melt the snow. So let's continue here. And I'll leave my chat box open since sadly I can see all your faces, but I cannot hear anything you're saying today. So wave your hand at me and then type in the chat box if I need to talk to you. All right. So just some comments first I wanted to make on long wave radiation in general. Basically, you know, everything around us emits radiation, and everything that has a temperature in the range of the Earth emits long wave radiation or terrestrial radiation. The sun is also emitting radiation, but it's at much shorter wavelengths, and that's shortwave radiation. But it's the same principle. It's emitting radiation proportional to its temperature. Roughly, this follows the Stefan-Boltzmann equation, which is epsilon, that's epsilon's emissivity, sigma, that's the Stefan-Boltzmann constant, 5.67 times 10 to the negative 8th, and then temperature to the 4th. Temperature here and in the SUMMA model is in Kelvin, and just remember Kelvin is 273.15 plus degrees Celsius. So anything above 273 Kelvin is above melting temperature. So the snow itself should not ever get above that temperature. When you get long wave radiation, so with sunlight, you can have a like direct beam of light. We have both direct and diffuse. With long wave, everything, there's no like direct beam long wave radiation. So it would be basically get long wave radiation from everything in a hemisphere around us and from the ground under our feet, but just all around. And so, you know, kind of a best way to get an idea of what is giving you long wave radiation might be to just, you know, imagine a dome over your head. What is coming in to the surface where you are? Water vapor is the Earth's most important greenhouse gas. It has a really high emissivity and it absorbs and emits a lot of long wave radiation. So water vapor, there's a reason why all of those empirical equations had something to do with temperature from the Stefan-Boltzmann equation, and something to do with water content, right? That's the emissivity in that. So moister air, like coastal air, has more water vapor and hence a higher emissivity than drier air, continental, hence it has more long wave radiation. A lot of people also make comments about turbulent flux. Turbulent flux sublimation and condensation is driven by a gradient from high to low vapor pressure. So do you think, just in general, would a maritime site compared to a continental site have more or less turbulent flux over the snow? So go ahead and type, since I still can't hear any of you, and my troubleshooting wasn't very helpful there. Yeah, so I see a lot of answers saying less. And in general, right, we would expect less turbulent flux happening in a maritime site, just because generally it's pretty saturated over the snow surface and it's pretty saturated in the air. So you don't have a strong gradient. The only exception is a rain on snow event where you have much more moisture in the air. Looks like Megan's confused with something. Can't quite tell. But in general, sublimation matters a whole lot in dry areas, and Pacific Northwest, like in the site and crevasse cluster, sublimation isn't much at all. All right. So thinking about long wave, pretend you are a clump of snow and tell me, and while you think about this, I am going to see if I can call in for audio because it's actually really lonely not to be able to hear you. So take a look at this one. I'm going to just escape there and go ahead and type in, what do you think here is contributing to long wave radiation? And I'm going to see if I can call in.
Okay, let's see if I can turn you on speakerphone. Let's see. All right. Can somebody say something? Can I not hear anything here? I hear something. Okay. I'm going to try putting this on speakerphone, and then I can hear you and vice versa. Hold on just a second while I see if I can make my phone go on speakerphone. Sorry for the technical difficulty. Okay. Speakerphone. Come on, be on speakerphone. Oh, come on.
Hello? Somebody talk to me.
Hello?
We can hear you.
I can hear you now. Excellent. How am I? Can you guys hear me? Does that sound okay?
It's a little muddled, but we can hear you.
No, I'm muddled. How's that? Is that better? Is that worse? Should I go back to the computer where you can hear me and I can't hear you?
That sounds better when you hold it closer.
Just hold it like right here. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. I can go back to the computer audio if I need to. I have no idea why it stopped talking to me today. All right. Yeah, so what you see here is, so what's contributing long-wave radiation to you is everything above you, right? So on the one on the left, people were commenting that you have, some trees in the sky. The one on the right, you have trees and buildings and some cement and other things, right? So it depends exactly where you're standing, how long-wave contributing. Which of these, the one on the left or the one on the right, do you think has more long wave coming in? If the air temperature is exactly the same, which one's going to give you more long wave?
Seems like the left.
Yeah, the one on the left, right? There's less sky. The sky has the least long wave, and the left has the most trees. You're going to get more from the trees. That's kind of the picture we're showing. So now we need to think about how is this actually represented in the model. All right, let's move forward. All right, so in the model, which I'm not sure I went into, and again, thinking about my short movie about my tree on the street. So in the model, your long wave radiation is modeled as a function of sky diffraction. So sky diffraction, as you look up, and this is a graphic by Keith Musselman in one of his papers, where he is showing, so talking on the phone is really annoying me too. I'm going to go back to the computer audio. Pardon me.
Okay, do you hear me? Yay, okay. Can somebody talk? Because it said I had output for just a minute. Somebody just talk, just testing.
Hi.
Hello.
Can you hear us now?
Okay, yeah. Okay, so I can't hear you, but I think you can hear me better. So I'll just read the chat. And then by Wednesday, I'll have figured this out somewhere. Okay. So let's go back to here. Okay, so sky view fraction. So how does sky view fraction come in? So in model land, this is how it's actually partitioned into the energy balance under the forest. And so what you see here is, so the net shortwave radiation that's felt under a forest is the incoming shortwave, so that's what's in your model parameter file, times the attenuation by the canopy, so that's how much incoming shortwave is attenuated, and then it's times one minus the albedo of the snow, right, however much is reflected back out of the canopy. Now the long wave, and that's what I want you to look at right now, is a function of the incoming long wave. This is what is in your meteorological forcing file. So that, as we just talked about, is a function of the air temperature, the relative humidity, the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere, and the cloud cover of the atmosphere. This is then weighted by the canopy sky view fraction. And then the canopy long wave is actually modeled differently. So it's not a function of what you guys were changing. It's a function where the canopy long wave is generally approximated by the air temperature, which is another parameter. And it emits to your snow in a one minus the canopy sky view fraction, right? So when you were looking up in that picture, we saw the trees, Everything you saw trees was the air temperature emitting to you. Everything you saw sky was what you put in that forcing file. So the reason you can see here why the one under the canopy was much less sensitive to what you were changing in this incoming sky is that it was just a much smaller fraction. It was actually making it to the forest. So it was still, you know, getting the impact of changing the long wave, but only in those gaps in the forest, only what made through. And the rest was a function of the air temperature, which you weren't really changing in your forcing files. And then minus the outgoing, which is a function of the snow surface temperature. So it's also adjusting here. Are there any questions? If there are, sorry, type them in your chat box because I can't hear you. Or you can also do charades if you prefer, but I probably won't understand them. Everybody okay with this? Help with the explanation? Okay, so just to compare this one step forward, we know that shortwave decreases under the forest and long wave increases under the forest. So what you see here are just two graphs showing forest on the left, open on the right. This is just sky view fraction. 0.5 is 50-50. If you looked above you, you'd see 50% open sky, 50% trees. And so you can see that long wave increases with temperature, but you're always gonna have more in the forest than in the open. And then short wave, you always have more in the open than the forest, but you can also see that it depends on time of year, just because there's more available shortwave radiation in the open. And this is just assuming a forest is completely shading you. You could also say some shortwave makes it through the forest as well, but the relative difference changes. The relative difference doesn't change so much for long wave, but it slides up and down. So this, just looking at this one more time. So this was why the open site was really sensitive to changes in the incoming long wave and not the forest site. And again, this is just highlighted with yellow here. And that's because the forest, the open site has a much greater sky view fraction. And so that's how the model's representing it. Does that clarify that question better? All right. Okay, so where we are logistics wise, homework one, critique one is all graded. I think you all did a great job with summarizing the paper. Homework one, the rubric is posted. It's in the assignments folder. If you sort by most recent thing I put up there, it'll come to the top. Note that I'm giving everybody 1 point for giving me a link to your Python notebook. And I think IPy notebook, you need a P in there, in HydroShare. If for some reason I couldn't find it, if you just make a comment on your assignment, say it is here, it's over here, or if you're having trouble uploading it and need a few more days to figure it out, I'll add in your point at that point in time. Some of you, I couldn't find it, so I'm giving you a chance to do that and you can get 1 point. I'm mostly through the grading, but not entirely. If you have a question about your scoring, if you look at the rubric and you look at the points I gave you and you think I missed something, let me know. Again, post a comment on it or send me an email. Some common issues. Some people had trouble with which variable were which in terms of the surface temperature. You really want the scalar surface temperature. If you made a mistake and plotted something else's temperature, just resubmit that part and I will regrade it without penalty, because I didn't realize there were other things that looked like snowfall temperature was a confusing one. Another common problem was, what does your variable actually mean? Scalar surface temperature is only the temperature of the snow when there's snow present. So the dominant thing you saw in your plots was when the snow disappeared, you started measuring soil temperature. A lot of people commented on how amazing it was that when you had high long wave, you got snow that was warmer than 273 Kelvin. That's unphysical. The snow cannot go above zero C. It can't go above 273 Kelvin. It becomes soil at that point. You're measuring soil. Soil surface temperature also will respond to long wave, but you want to be really careful with your terminology and what you're talking about. Also, you know, whenever you're making plots, you know, think really carefully. If there's anything in there that just seems slightly odd, it probably is. If you have absolutely identical values across, if you change almost anything in the model, you will change the response variable slightly. Even if it's not very sensitive to it, you'll usually change things slightly. If things are absolutely perfectly identical, so you haven't changed SWE or surface temperature at all, what you probably did was overwrote the file. It's easy to do when you're sort of doing the sensitivity, just changing the file names, to just perturb something and overwrite the earlier file because you didn't do what you're writing to. If you make the plot and you're like, wait, these two look exactly the same, it's probably because it is the same model run and you just accidentally gave the same run two names. Again, what I said before, snow surface temperatures are going above zero C. Either something went terribly wrong or you're interpreting something wrong. So those are just key things to check for. Logistics-wise, where we are here, I switched the order in case anyone was really excited about distributing a snow model today. I decided that in sort of looking at homework one and knowing you guys are working on homework two, I want to talk about calibration evaluation. How do you really look at your model output? How do you know you have good model output? So I just switched that to today. Reading two critique is due before you go to sleep tonight. Any questions on that? I think that one should be pretty straightforward. Just comment on what you're seeing there. The more challenging one is going to be homework two. It's due on Friday, but the one part I want you to make sure I know before class on Wednesday is just your groups, because that's coming up next Monday. And I want a chance just to check in with people. We only have one class session before our last one. So I posted on the discussion section, about half the people had groups and plans on at the end of homework one, and about half the people don't. So make sure you have it to me by Wednesday. Again, doesn't have to be in depth, just this is, you know, the names of people in my group, general idea of what we're doing. Some people really wanted their own forcing data or wanted to look at different locations. Given the timeline that you really only have a week from today, I highly recommend you just don't do that. Pick something that's a slight perturbation on something that's already one of the homeworks. You know, one of the questions that we didn't answer, or repeating the homework at another site where the data is already in there. Pick something fairly straightforward. Don't do anything more, unless you just have nothing else on your plate whatsoever for next week. Don't pick anything too hard. I'm expecting about the same level of what you would do in a homework assignment, nothing more than that. Just again, to before I jump into like more general model evaluation, as you're starting to work on, you just got through homework one, you're starting to work on homework two. Homework one told you exactly what to plot, said, look at this, look at that. Homework two says, like, what's different? Make some plots. And so the question is, like, how do you know what to plot and what to look at? And so I'm going to show you some results from homework two last year. It was the same layering experience, but it was a different location. So your results may be totally different, but this should give you a few ideas of, like, what you might want to plot. So last year, instead of being at CUAHSI site, we were at Reynolds Mountain East site in Idaho. So here is a picture of the site. This is the sheltered site. Chris was asking me if there is any wind measurements here. The model has wind measurements, but I'm pretty sure that there are no physical wind measurements right here. So I think what's in the forcing file is wind from somewhere else, just presuming it's the same here above the canopy. Unless you see a wind sensor in this picture. I don't think they actually measured wind at the sheltered site. Again, our layering exercise, we had four layering schemes, and we want to know what's the difference, what's going on here. And the key really is that, you know, there's a lot going on, and plotting data, just looking at output from your model, is another skill that takes a lot of practice. Just for a moment, and I have no idea why this keeps doing this. Type, what were your thoughts on screen sharing? My screen is just not working. All my audio visual things are not working well today. All right, so what are people's thoughts on the plotting that they did so far? So just go ahead and type in your chat. Some thoughts you had on plotting so far. Anybody think of any great insights just from the first homework or what you've started playing with second homework? Yeah, so Victoria writes it that the long time series aren't so helpful. You really need to zoom in to a certain time in the season. Also, it's like for really long time series, summary stats, actually the mean is often more helpful than just looking at them, particularly ones like temperature or longer that go up and down every day, give a lot of fluctuations. It's really hard to see. It's really hard to plot the thickness of the top layer. Yeah, sometimes finding the variable you want is really quite tricky. It's really important to have examples. And the other thing I would recommend that if people make a cool plot and they're like, I really like this, this is a great plot or a really good piece of Python code, share, post a discussion, put it in HydroShare and send the link. In terms of plotting, I mean, I'm not trying, it's not a computer science class. It's something else you need to know in addition to all the modeling. So please do share with each other and I'll try to post ones I have, grab the examples. So I'm gonna go through a few things I use. So my tip number one, when I start, I always start with plotting whatever thing is that I'm most sure I know the answer to. Basically, the first plot I make is I want to make sure I actually labeled all my runs correctly and they all did what I think they did, right? So for example, this is the layer run. I know the Jordan scheme has way more layers than the rest. I just do a plot of everything with the number of layers, right? Do all the two layer runs actually have two layers? Does the five layer run have five layers? Do I have one run with a lot of layers? Okay, you know, I've labeled them right, I'm happy. It is so easy to do stupid tiny things that will then throw you off for the rest of the day that I always start plotting something I know the answer to. My next tip is I plot the entire run duration to check for something that went egregiously wrong. But it's really, as Victoria wrote, it's not very informative in terms of process representation, right? Here, it's hard to tell, like, okay, did they make a difference? Maybe they made a tiny difference. You know, it's SWE over 4 years at once is hard to see. So I often go and do 1 year at a time. I like to just focus on 1 year. And so what you saw in terms of Reynolds Creek, and you may get totally different answers at Q's, is that, you know, the Jordan layer accumulated less snow than the other ones is what happened in the two largest years. Another thing is that in most of the years, 3 out of 4, the density during melt was lower in the two layer runs than in the other runs. That's where I have my blue arrow over here. And so that was because there was less liquid water retained in the two layer runs. That's something you might want to look for. Also, you'll notice when I start looking at snow surface temperature, I plot like only a week at a time. The really long plots, you just can't see anything. I also, like, in terms of figuring out melt, I like to zoom in to just the melt season to look what's going on. And you can see, at least at Reynolds, it may be different at Q's. The two layer thin has the largest fluctuations and cools the quickest, and the two-layer thick takes the longest to both get up and go down. You may see something different, but also it's hard to tell this diurnal variation without zooming in to just a day or two. So think about looking closely. And so how do you decide what you plot? it's a really good idea, and this is what we'll be going over today, to take a moment to really think about why you did these runs in the first place. And you can see from my plots is that for this particular location, if your goal was just to get a reasonable estimate of snow water equivalent at Reynolds Creek, my runs, they had about a five day difference in meltout date. And if 5 day difference doesn't make a big difference, the two layer model might be fine, right? And it might be done. I say, okay, they all get close. If that's all I want to do, I've made enough plots, it didn't really matter. Maybe if your goal is to use your model to estimate density to combine with a depth measurement, such as from LIDAR or photogrammetry, or you just have a depth sensor, you might have noticed, wow, the density really didn't look quite right in those two layer models. So then you might say, okay, I need a 5 layer model. And then you might also be done, right? You say, okay, I'm in enough plots. I really looked at density. That's what I cared about. You know, if your goal is to explain how snow models work, because you're just obsessed with snow models, you have to teach a class on the subject or something else, you might make more plots, right? But you need to prioritize, like, what are you trying to learn from this? And since, of course, you can tell I fall in the latter category, I made more plots. So we can look at fluxes of variables into and out of the snowpack. So even if we are trying to figure out the effects of layering, and we know we gave it all the same energy balance forcing, we might want to know, you know, how is water being lost to you? I've got here a sublimation, sensible heat flux, and drainage at the bottom of the snowpack. The first thing you know looking at this is that this is not very informative either, right? They all plot on top of each other. Maybe they're different. I couldn't, but these plots are not particularly helpful. If I change them to cumulative plots, so I accumulate through time, I can start seeing differences, right? That the reason why on homework one, you guys were noticing that, you know, SWE was a much cleaner variable to plot than surface temperature is because the surface temperature is instantaneous and the SWE is a cumulative mass balance over time. And so if you do cumulative fluxes, you can start saying, oh, this is actually quite different than that. So what you can see in this plot when I've changed them all to cumulative fluxes is that you can see in this case that the sensible heat flux was about almost the same in all the models. Something different happened in sublimation in the two layer thick where it ended up. And something different happened in the cumulative drainage at the bottom in the two layer thick. So, you know, you might be curious, well, why, what went wrong with that one? And that it really seemed to go different right here in December, right? You can see when does that cumulative plot diverge from all the rest. So then you would notice, okay, something went different here. So then I can zoom into a few days here and say, okay, well, what's happening, right? What's happening with the actual fluxes at that time? Because in the big plot, they didn't make sense. I wouldn't know where to zoom unless I made the cumulative plot. So I made the cumulative plot, I can look in, I say, okay, well, right here, around December 15th, I can see there's drainage out of everything except for the two layer thick, and there's sublimation out of everything except for the two layers thick. And the sensible heat flux looks a little different. So what's going on here? And then I go look at the snow surface temperature about the same time, and I say, wait, this is what I told you before. For some reason, my snow surface temperature went above zero. I don't believe it can go above zero, right? So this is called something is not happening right in my model. Also, SWE decreased slightly, but I said I had no sublimation, I had no drainage. So what's going on? So I told Martin the whole model was broken. He wrote back to me that it was not broken, that I had just overlooked the special case of snow without a layer. So something you may encounter, if you get something weird that looks like this in your runs, what is happening is that if you plot the number of layers and you go look, and I was obsessed with what was happening to snow right about 12, 15 in this year, that there are zero snow layers in the two layer thick during the time period we observe all these oddities. All the rest have snow layers. And so when you have snow without a layer, you're accounting it differently. And if you remember from the reading that you're turning in at some point today, that actually that having snow not as an independent layer, but as part of the soil layer is a choice in a lot of land surface models. And weird things can happen in accounting when you do that. So then you say, okay, well, what's happening there? And to go on, this is kind of just walking you through detective work with layers. You go back to the paper, right? See, layers are subdivided or combined when layer depths meet. This is now I have all your pictures on top of this. When layer depths meet specific criteria, and a snow layer is divided into two when its depth is larger than a prescribed threshold. Okay, does that make sense? We have to go back to, wait, what on earth did we do in our SUMA model? So you can go, this is what we were all changing as part of this. We're changing all these things that are called, you know, Z min layer lower, Z min layer upper. And if you're anything like me, you're kind of looking at, say, okay, yeah, follow directions, but I'm not sure what these parameters really mean. Anybody in that category? On earth is Z min layer, whatever. Okay, so let's start with only the first column of numbers actually matters. So don't worry about the other two. Those are guidelines of what you should put in for the parameters. So the first ones tell us what's going on and what do they actually mean. So the first one, Z min layer, is by the rules. It says if the snow thickness drops below this minimum, we combine layers. We don't keep it as a separate layer. And this is used, you can also, if you want to see where it is in the Fortran code, this is used in layermerge.f90. So you can see that we change Z min layer 1 from 0.0075 to 0.05. So at five centimeters, we combine the layer. You also see there's Z max layer lower and Z max layer upper, which we changed as well. So Z max layer lower is the maximum layer depth for the top upper layer when there's only one layer, which means it's also the lower layer. So there's one layer, but it's also at the bottom of the snowpack. So we set this to 0.2, 200 millimeters, to force that top layer to be thick. In order to make it thick, we said that we have to build a thick enough snowpack to start with that top layer. And then we set the Zmax layer upper as the maximum layer depth for the top upper layer when there's more than one layer. And we had to set this, we set this to 1.5. So for what we ended up telling it to do is that the first layer minimum needed to get above 200 millimeters, and then it needs to stay at least 150 millimeters. We then only create a snow layer, and this is in layer divide, when the snow depth is greater than our parameter. So just when Zmax layer 1 lower, which we set to 200. So this keeps us from making more than two layers. That one needs to be higher to stop us from dividing and making more layers. If all of this is still a little confusing, don't worry. You don't have to totally understand it. It's just that you can get odd things. So here, if we look at our snow depth in the water year 2003, where it's getting weird things, and we look at this period when we were getting weird things, we have to realize that because of the thresholds used, we're requiring that the snow depth has to get deep before you have a snow layer. And these are Martin's words. In this case, the snow is implicit or combined with the top soil layer. And the snow can melt if the temperature of the top soil layer gets above zero, but the temperature can get above zero. The snow itself doesn't. And then the melt increases the ponded water and is tracked as part of the soil water balance. So it doesn't show up in terms of the water balance terms I was using. So again, it probably won't be much in your runs, and it was only it only happened in 1 year. It depends on how the snow falls, if you just get something right in that threshold, but this could be something that happens. So here is just a picture of our snow depth at Reynolds Creek, and based on thresholds we set in the layers, you can see that right here at 50 millimeters, CLM standard builds a layer of snow that's separate, and that the two layer thick weights all the way up to 200 millimeters. So there's a fair bit of time where snow is, you know, melting and doing things where all of the snow models, except for the thick surface layer, actually have snow, and that one doesn't. It just completely confuses you, but this is how, if you really want to know about the mechanics. So if your first level was, I want roughly the right SWE, you could be done with the early plots. If you wanted a level of, I actually really want to understand what snow layers do and I'm obsessed with this, then you can get to this layer plots. And it goes back to what your goal is. One other interesting thing, does anyone have any ideas why having more layers, why the Jordan one actually led to less total snow in 2 years? Any ideas? I'll give you one hint. So it's occurring as drainage. It's not occurring as sublimation, right? So we can plot cumulative sublimation, cumulative heat flux, cumulative drainage. You can see that Jordan has more drainage. You can see it's also, it's happening primarily in December. So another hint, the drainage is occurring when the snow surface temperatures are very, very cold, negative 20 to negative 30. It's not getting up to zero. Drainage isn't starting at the top. So give me an idea what you think's happening or what you would plot next to figure it out. Soil temperature, yeah. Connor's got, we all have soil people here. So why would the 100 layer model be the only one that would respond to soil temperature? It's a thin bottom layer. Mm-hmm. So it's the only one with a thin enough layer near the bottom of the snowpack to actually cause melt due to warm soil temperatures. It's the only one that you can get ground heat flux mattering on. And so all the other ones, as Katrina says, have the higher specific heat and it takes more energy to melt. So they never got enough from the soil heat flux to melt that lower layer, whereas the lower layers in the Jordan scheme were melting. All right, any questions there? Go ahead and close this and go to some general things on model evaluation. Okay. All right. So these are just some general, this is not part of your homework. Before were hints for the homework. These are more just moving forward. How do you do model evaluation of anything? We asked on the reading, like, how would you know if you had the right model? How would you determine if you had two models, which was good? And so these are what data you might use, what are the metrics you might use, and how can you find errors? And this is just to reiterate what I said about, you know, before you start evaluating anything, you should figure out what you're doing and why. So I'll give you just a minute to read what Calvin says on this, because Calvin's the best snow scientist of Cartoon Land. So part of it is, as Calvin says, is everything's equally valid, like why even bother to evaluate? But by the same token, if we just want a perfect model everywhere in every way all the time, it's just not gonna happen. So we need to think about, you know, what are we doing? What is our goal with our specific study? You know, who are our deliverables? And are we evaluating fairly for what we're trying to do? And we need to prioritize, just like I mentioned, prioritizing with the plots. So we'll talk about available data, the relative usefulness of different types of data at different phases of the snow evolution, and then we'll go through some metrics that are just common methods people use in published papers, and then some specific examples from Drew Slater about how you really should look at those metrics, like what do these metrics and numbers mean anyway, particularly when you're using snow data. Okay, so if you remember Mark Raleigh's ideal weather station, things we typically use for model evaluation are snow water equivalent measured by our snow pillow, snow depth, from the two of those we can get snow density, surface temperature, and downward long wave or short wave radiation. So we can get a measurement of the albedo and surface energy fluxes, and then we can get a measurement of the mass balance. You might have, but not likely, you might have a snow lysimeter that weighs the snow and collects all the snow in a tipping bucket, so you could actually measure melt out the bottom. We had one of those, the snow kept freezing in the tipping bucket, so it didn't work really well. But some places they work absolutely great. You might have a snowboard, which would give you 24-hour new snow accumulation. You get depth and density. You might have, and I think this is H.P. Marshall here, snow depth measurements. You might have a complete density and temperature profile, so you could actually compare with that whole profile from the plots you'll be making for homework two. You might have manual snow surveys where people went and walked around. You might have time-lapse photos of things where you can see how much snow is on the ground. You might have some creative temperature arrays. This is one put out by Mike and Julia Dettinger, and here's the data where you actually could see the temperature inside the snowpack at Dana Meadows through time from all these little temperature sensors until they started melting the snow around them, and then they measured air temperature. You might want to choose to evaluate your model at an ideal experimental watershed. Here's a picture of Reynolds Creek CZO, which has many MET stations, many soil measurements, many snow courses, many weirs. You could compare your model at a lot of points. Generally, you want to check your model at places with as many measurements as possible before you start taking them places where you don't have any measurements. For distributed studies, you probably want to compare against stream flow or satellite or aerial remote sensing. Did you put snow all over your watershed at the right time? Do you have the right volume of water coming out at the bottom of a river gauge? And then at different times of the year, you probably really want to emphasize different evaluation metrics. And a lot of people commented on this on homework one, is that once the snow surface temperature got to be zero, everything was zero and everything was melting. And so it stopped being useful. And it was the rate of decrease, right? The rate at which the snow was going down was the most useful metric. So I like to think about it when I do evaluations as three different parts of the snow energy balance. And this is guided by the fact that I live in the Western US where we tend to have an accumulation, a midwinter season and then a melt season. But this is true a lot of places. So snow accumulation depends on precipitation and snow drifting. So when I'm trying to evaluate my precip metrics, I only look at this part of the season. With homework one, a lot of people noted that like the early part, everything matched. It didn't matter what long wave did because we fed that all the same precipitation. They all started out with the same amount of snow. Then things started diverging because we were changing the long wave in the energy balance. So the middle period is the snow may not be melting a lot. It was in Oregon, but a lot of places it might not. And when the snow's cold up until snow temperature gets to zero, then the evolution of the snow temperature is really determining whether melt will start. And this is when snow density and liquid water content may change. This is when you might want to track snow density. It's when you want to track snow surface temperature. Then the final season, once you get into melt, surface temperature is no longer a useful metric. Now depth and SWE are changing. And as you get towards the end, snow covered area becomes really important. So metrics like looking with MODIS or Landsat of where there is and is not snow on the landscape really becomes most useful at the very end of the melt season. It's not very useful earlier when there is snow everywhere. So you really, for best case scenario, you want to be changing what you're using to compare to your snow model at different times of year to give yourself as much information as possible. This is showing the same plot, but with temperature of the snowpack. Again, snow melt and disappearance over here on the right. It's all orange, warmer, 0 degrees. Temperatures, not very interesting here. Here you really want to be looking at the change in snow depth and snow water equivalent. However, this middle period is when you actually see quite a bit of variation in temperature, and it's an exact different time when you don't see variation in depth. So again, it's just to highlight that at different times of year, different metrics of evaluation are more useful. All right, so okay, we have some metrics now. How do we use them? What should we do with our numbers? So here are just some examples from the literature. So this is a figure from a paper by Richard Esery. I think it's called like 2001 snow models. I may have the number wrong, but it's some large number of snow models. And so what he does is the circles are the observations, the lines are all the model runs, and he selected the best models by minimizing the root mean squared error, both for the individual variables. So he compared with snow mass, he compared with snow albedo, he compared with snow depth, and he compared with snow surface temperature. And you can see that when surface temperature also includes soil temperature here, right? 10 degrees C is not snow surface. And they also did a weighted cost function of all four variables. How well did it match everything? Root mean squared error is very common. Here's a list of just other papers that have used root mean squared error to determine what qualified as good model. Christy Franz in 2008 was evaluating a number of models, and she used a lot of metrics. So in addition to root mean squared error, which Richard Esery used, and I've got the equations here in case it's useful to have them all in one place. She also calculated the mean error, the Nash-Sutcliffe efficiency, the percent bias, and the correlation coefficient. You know, does it go up and down at the same time? How biased is it? Is always more or less than some number? And then the Nash-Sutcliffe efficiency is saying how different is it from if you just guessed the mean. James and Burgess really recommend making lots and lots of plots, and scatter plots are very, very useful. On at least one of the homework assignments I had asked a question about, is surface temperature related to long wave? And someone made a scatter plot of the long wave versus the surface temperature, and definitely they plotted on a scatter plot with a relationship. If there's two things you want to know if they have something to do with each other, this can help. It also can give you an idea of, and here these are just simple scatter plots showing recorded versus simulated magnitudes of different things. That you can see, you know, example of, you know, all of the simulated magnitudes are too low. Uniform bias, you can see, you know, the higher magnitudes are really simulated too low. You can see in C, the higher magnitudes are too high and the lower magnitudes are too low. And a nice, you know, scatter plot evenly around the one-to-one line shows that, okay, there's no systematic error. There's random error, but it's not systematic. So scatter plots can really help you think about types of error. Time series plots, as I just showed you, can be useful in zooming in to different times and looking at them. This is a paper by Kumar et al. And they plotted everything. They determined the coefficient of determination, which is basically the square of the correlation coefficient. And they also determined the Nash-Sutcliffe efficiency to decide which of all their different models were good or bad. Another set of things that were recommended for evaluating snow in particular, a nice write-up is in Mizukami et al. 2014, who was really talking about snow and runoff signatures. So again, how do you decide what to do? What are you most interested in? Is, you know, often if we want to know, you know, timing of when snow disappears, we might want to know the centroid of the annual SWE time series. This is a typical metric if climate is changing and then snow is just disappearing earlier each year, you know, what is the weighted time? So this is just integral of time times the amount of SWE over all SWE. You know, what time of year is most of the mass of SWE concentrated at? And then you can look, is that changing? Do you get the timing right? Peak SWE, I know some people in their homework just output the max SWE, is a fairly easy metric to pull. You could look what that is. Snow length, how many days do you have snow water equivalent greater than some threshold. You're going to hydrology, the runoff ratio, and then similar to the centroid of the snow time series, what's the centroid of the runoff time series? This has been used commonly in timing of annual runoff. If you have more rain, less snow, it shifts towards earlier in the year. And you might want to know, can my model capture that? Maybe it doesn't get storms really well, but it gets that centroid right. And what I'm interested in is that seasonal shift. So again, thinking about what metrics you want for your study, which ones matter to you most, and then those are the ones you should be using to evaluate your model's performance. So just a summary, I just put up a whole lot of different metrics. There's a number that are just, goodness of fit variables for any time series pair, right? There's correlation, how well do they both go up and down at the same time. This will minimize magnitude differences if you just, want things to go up and down at the same time. That's fair. Most people notice that the long wave, they all, the snow seemed to go up and down at the same time. That was okay. The magnitude was off. Root mean squared error will emphasize outliers. Mean absolute error puts less emphasis on the outliers. Again, depending on your goals and application, if you want extreme events, you probably want more emphasis on the outliers. If you think the extreme events are just errors in your measurements, you probably don't. Bias, I think in terms of something that accumulates over time, in terms of the long wave estimates, the bias was the best predictor of how good or bad long wave is going to do at predicting our snow evolution. If it was wrong, but indifferent, wrong in correlation, but it didn't have a bias, it actually didn't hurt our snow so much. Notch Sutcliffe efficiency typically only for stream flow, but occasionally you'll see it used for snow. This is how well do you do compared to only forecasting the mean. In this case, one is perfect. Less than zero means pretty terrible. Less than zero means you should have just gone with the mean. You're making things worse. And then characteristic signatures, center of mass, centroid of timing, runoff ratio, and total snow season duration. So you might want to, pick a variety of these or just a few. I don't know. I don't have a strong opinion. Examples of how you might want to also look at as many things as possible. This is from a paper by Nick Wayan in 2013. And he's running DHSVM, which is a snow model and a streamflow model. And he just changed the forcing data. So it's similar to the experiment you just did. So he changed all the forcing data. So he took all the forcing data from WRF, and then he took forcing data from a weather station that was labeled Secret Town. We just like the name. Secret weather station, plus PRISM, which is a statistical method of distributing precipitation. So if you looked over here, elevation versus peak SWE, and the observations are in blue with the label of the observation there, and then by gradient with elevation, you can see here that if you looked just at peak SWE, it looks like DHSVM force with WRF is much better. So if that was all you looked at, you'd say, okay, we're going to go with WRF. But then if you look at the total precipitation, you look here and you say, well, I don't know, maybe they're about the same, but I can't tell one's a winner in total precipitation here. And if I go and look at temperature, it looks like WRF is worse at temperature. So how on earth, if it's worse at temperature, could it be getting better at SWE? And you wouldn't come to this point unless you started plotting everything else, right? If you just made the first plot, you would have said, hands down, WRF wins, I'm done. So what actually was happening is you go and do a time series plot, say, okay, here's my observations, so snow accumulates and melts. Here's two sites, one higher elevation, one lower elevation. And you can see that the higher elevation one has more total SWE and the lower elevation one has more total wind winter melt. And if you look at DHSVM forced by WRF, what you see is that it actually is accumulating more total snow and it's also melting faster. So it overaccumulates and overmelts, but it ends up getting the peak SWE really pretty close to right. This is just showing overaccumulation and overmelt here. Whereas DHSVM forced by Secret Town and PRISM actually didn't get enough snow in the second storm, but actually melted at a much more close to regular rate. It didn't have this bias in temperature. So compensating errors can come to bite you so many ways in snow modeling. So be careful with your metrics and again, what you want. If all you want is peak SWE, definitely DHSCM with WRF was getting that better for this year, but it was getting it because two wrongs were making a right. So, you know, it really underpredict by quite a bit here. All right, so are there any questions so far? Anybody, you're doing okay? Can you? Okay, I'm gonna show you Drew Slater's analysis that he put together for the first snow modeling class I ever taught. And Drew's no longer with us, so you only get Drew presentations by virtue of me or recordings now. But he spent a lot of time modeling and a lot of time doing evaluation. And I really like these slides because it really helps put those metrics, which I showed you, these are just what people used, in a framework of like, what do they really mean? What does a root mean squared error of a certain number tell me? What's good or bad? Like, these are numbers that are hard to put in our sense of big, small, or otherwise. So this is SWE root mean squared error from a model doing simulations at 599 snowtail stations. That's where they got a weather station and a truck light for the pillow, snow pillow, measuring the weight of the snow. And so you can see that the root mean squared error just plotted, calculated with this model, goes from close to zero to up to 250 kilograms per meter squared at these. These are just the station numbers. It's a huge range. Now the first thing you might change is that the red line includes all the times there is zero snow. The blue line only includes observations that have greater than zero snow. So you may notice, if you're comparing models in different papers, that people who choose to compare, I got a zero when there was zero snow, model snow beautifully all summer when it's super hot and dry and there's no snow, and their metrics will all look better than somebody who only compares against time when there's snow on the ground. Across all stations, everywhere. Makes sense? So if you say like there's a lot of time with zero snow, you can get better metrics, but it might not be fair. Another thing is that your SWE root mean squared error is a function of how much your mean annual maximum SWE is, right? That your error is likely going to be larger at places where there's more total snow water equivalent and smaller at places where there's less, right? That just, if all you're doing is plotting a simple, kilograms of snow, how much snow on the ground there is, it's gonna be bigger where there is more snow. So again, is that a fair metric of your model, or is that just saying there's more snow over here? So maybe we want to normalize that, right? A more percent error might be more helpful. So now we'll normalize it. So we'll basically, divide by the average amount of snow. And generally what happens when you do that is you see, so now we no longer have a increase in error with higher. We now have that the percentage error is actually higher with the smaller locations. You'll see these kinds of patterns in almost any map people make with models, where they're trying to show you how well they simulate snow across the continental US, or how well they're trying to simulate snow over the globe. Is that if somebody is showing you an absolute amount of error, they're going to have the biggest error in places with the most snow. And if somebody is showing you a percent error or normalized, they're going to have the biggest error in the places with the least snow, right? You're dividing by a small number. So I often like to do both plots to kind of look at both. And it's important to think about how metrics have been normalized and how the metrics are sort of inherently biased by the construction of the metric. Another thing that you might want to look at is here's the normalized root mean squared error. So it's normalized by the average sweep, but also by the snow regime. How variable is snow in a given place, right? If snow does the same every single year somewhere, we would presume we probably could calibrate a model to just match it all the time. We could just say last year happens again, right? We don't even need much physics. But if we look at the coefficient of variation in the mean annual sweep, so how much, just how variable is snow in a given location naturally, right? We'd imagine it's gonna be harder to model somewhere that's naturally variable. You can see that our normalized sweep goes up as a coefficient of variation, just as the variability of snow at a site goes up. All right, so another question is, okay, when does a metric represent a quote unquote good model? So here we have observations in the red, the model in the blue, and you can see the simulations for one site called Pole Creek, another site called White Horse Lake. These are both snowtell sites in the US. The coefficient of variation, or CV, is the standard deviation divided by the mean. And you can see here are metrics. So here's the root mean squared error. For the top one is 59.4 millimeters. The bottom one is 28. The normalized root mean squared error for the top one is 11%. The bottom one is 26%. The maximum SWE for the top one is 548. It's only 108 for the bottom one, average maximum SWE. And then the coefficient of variation is sort of a measure of the variability in the standard deviation divided by the mean. So which one do you think is the better model? You can point to you can do number one for the top one, number two for the bottom one, or you can say both by just waving your hand. We got to vote for both. Only one person voted at all. Both good model. Got some more. You're all gonna say for both. The harder ones, the lower one's a harder location to model, right? The metrics in general are worse there. But when you normalize it, and you consider the coefficient of variation, then having 26 per error doesn't look too bad. You can also see that the root mean square error by itself just makes the one with more SWE look bigger, even though like visually, when we look at the graph, I think that one actually looks better. Okay. All right, so here's another site. This is Divide, and Model A is a model that Drew Slater invented. And how complicated, so here's the metrics. So out of a snow water equivalent of, roughly peaks at 300 millimeters, the root mean squared error of this model is 37.1 millimeters. The Nash Sutcliffe is 0.9, so that's one is perfect, not bad. Correlation is 0.95. So on a scale of one being the simplest model and five being a very complicated model, hold up your fingers, since I can't hear you, of what do you think? You're gonna grade on a scale of one to five, simple to complex. How complicated do you think this model is with these excellent modeling statistical scores? You got ones and twos. Nobody thinks it's a very complicated model at all. You guys are good. You guys are good. Here it is. Model A simply assumes that the average snowpack repeats every single year. It does remarkably well. This is a site where the average snowpack is a really good metric. So another thing you might want to compare your statistics against if you're trying to develop a model is if I want to, especially if you're trying to develop a model for practical applications, like if you want a water manager to make a decision, can your fancy model with all the bells and whistles do better than just presuming that the snow this year is just like the snow last year? And if it doesn't, then they probably aren't going to pay you any more money, and that's fair, right? They should just say the snow this year will be like the snow last year. So here's model B, and it does better, but the numbers actually don't look that much better. So again, how much is it worth to be better? And it's model evaluation is very subjective. You have to be honest with yourself and think about what you need and what you care about and whether you think you're getting the right answers for the right reasons. Here is actually a case, this is the Tizer Basin snowtail, where guessing the average actually does better than the model. So the root mean squared error goes up from trying to model. And the correlation goes down. But it's worth also, just when you're doing your metrics, see how your metrics compare to just guessing the average. You should be able to beat that. Another question is what does an observation mean? Your snowtails are at a location, they're a spot, but they're representative of their spot. They may not be representative somewhere else. This is a graphic photo by Matthew Sturm. This is a site that I helped with. This was, we went out on the snowmobiles you saw the picture of at the very beginning, and went down these lines, and you'd snowmobile along, and then you'd go and you'd probe depth everywhere along there. And then where you see these little swirly things, these are what we call the Heimstra death spirals, because this is where Chris Heimstra gets in the magnetoprobe, and he can do this and no one else can, or at least very few people can. I can't. He walks in a circle, a tight circle, as I say, and gets as many depth probes as he possibly can. So you've measured depth everywhere. And if you put all of this together, here's an actual map of what snow depth looks like in what looks like a fairly simple place, right? Some of you said on the first homework assignment, okay, if you don't have any trees and you just have shallow snow, you don't need to be complicated. So if you bother to make all the measurements of all these people on their snowmobiles with their depth probes out for 2 weeks, you can see that, and this is turned upside down because that's where this aerial picture is taken from, is that over here on this side, you have 100 centimeters of snow, and then you have places here that have only half of that. And if you only had a measurement in one spot, you would not get the average amount of snow over even this one satellite-sized grid cell accurately. So you want to think about what you're doing and what you need, both at a point and spatially. Satellite data, here's a picture of Martin going out in the American River Basin because he was supposed to model it, and just looking completely confused while he's staring at all the trees. What does snow cover actually mean? You may get plots where you can't see anything. It says it's bare of snow, but it's actually trees with snow underneath that it can't see. There may be clouds. The top one has clouds in the way that you can't see. So if you're trying to assimilate satellite data, what does it actually tell you? Also, when you're trying to compare an observation with a model, is your observation actually a model variable? Or is your observation valid for what it is and the model is valid for what it is? They're both doing fine, but you are trying to compare apples and oranges. You need to actually think, is this thing I'm measuring actually the same as the output in the model? And personally, being an observationalist, I find it tends to be easier to modify the model to output something close to your observation than to get a better observation somewhere. But you want to make sure they're doing the same thing. This is similar to what I was pointing out earlier, is that if you have snow and a composite layer in your land surface model, what the land surface model is outputting is not the same of what you are measuring directly over the snow. Whereas if you have a multi-layer snowpack on top of the soil surface, then what is on top of the snow and your measurement right on top of the snow are more likely to match. Similarly, is over on the left, is the horizontal structure and discretization, is that fluxes to the atmosphere, some land surface models are trying to come up with an effective parameter. They want flux over a mix of trees and snow and all kinds of stuff. And that might be fine for that model, but it's not gonna match a measurement made over a specific snow patch under the trees. Whereas subgrid tiles might actually have measurements that you could match up with specific, might actually have model output that you could match with specific measurements. Okay, I measured this spot over a tree, I measured this spot over soil, I measured this spot over snow, and they're all output from my model. So you need to think about the footprint and how things are aggregated. Another thing to consider in model evaluation are products. For example, you could download SnowDAS, which is a model with various things assimilated into it that you can get all over the Western US very easily. But it's hard to figure out what all went into it. You will find papers where people treat products, which are a mix of measurements and models, as observations. That's a dangerous thing to do unless you can trace back and figure out where everything came from, because some places it's very good, other places it's not. And sometimes it's very hard to track where actual observations were incorporated in the model and when you're just comparing your model to someone else's model. And it's not fair to call that model observations and yours not. And here's just an example, which I showed you, I think, on the first day, the big picture average from 2000 to 2009 of snow products, global snow products that you could go get and download. This is what they say is mean March snow water equivalent over a 10-year average. And they tell you everything under the sun out here. It's quite variable, both in space and magnitude. This is the same set of model products. They're mixture model observation-based products, and how well they're correlated with each other. I haven't spent the time to do this, but I imagine if I went and did these model history family trees of like which model was developed where and who's citing whom, you'll probably see the correlations here based on ones that are developed by the same line of thought matching other ones developed from the same line of thought much more. So just treat them with care. It's beyond the scope of this class to go into what they all are. There also are likely functional relationships in all the models. So here on the right, you see this is from Drew's paper you just read on the PILP study, showing all of the different ways that snow is incorporated in land surface models, from a multi-layer model down here on the bottom to a bulk layer model to implicit. That's what I was showing you, like before we got a layer, what happens if the snow is part of the soil. The surface can actually go above zero if the snow is part of the soil. And then how are these different model structures related to how they might interpret a change in some parameter, such as a change in the mean air temperature and what it does to the soil. The one that explicitly had the snow had a much stronger response than the other one. And this one actually more closely matches the observations. So all these decisions can follow through. And I know I'm not being inspiring. I'm just sounding like the world's a mess here, but just be aware of it and try to do the best. Okay, so model diagnosis. All right, so here's a model. This is a observations are red, model is blue. Type in what is the first thing you would fix about the snow model? When you see how something wrong, you're going to try to fix something. What do you want to do here? Yeah, so Megan says there's a bias. The model is always higher than the observation. It is. So what should we do? What should we change in our model? We have too much snow. Pretty much every year all the time. Yes, Allison says precip. Victoria says snowfall precip. Connor says the rain snow threshold. I think that the first thing, and generally remember I told you divide up the parts of the snowpack, right? So the first thing I would do here is I tend to look at accumulation, right? Accumulating, we are pretty much all, Laxmi says we need a recalibration. Yep, we got to change something. And a way to get it is I start with accumulation, right? Let's start with the right amount of snow. So the first step is, okay, this has too much snow all the time. Let's try adjusting the precip we're putting in it. Let's put in less snowfall. We could do that. We should look at the temperature. If we're close to the rain snow threshold, we might get that by adjusting that a little bit and making it have more rain, less snow. If we're not close to that threshold, it won't do anything. And then we can just say, okay, where did we get our precip from? Maybe we don't trust it. I think I convinced you early on it's off enough by a factor of two. So, changing this is fair game. Okay, so, all right. All right, so we just decreased the precipitation. All right, so we decreased the precipitation. So now, after that step, you run your model again. Now, what's the next thing you would fix in the snow model? So now it's getting about peak sway about, right? It still has a consistent problem. So melt timing's off. So what are we going to change? What can we do? So the melt's starting too late. Mm-hmm. So what can we do? You guys have already done it once. You should know. Can change the long wave. Yeah, you need to change something with energy balance. Incoming radiation is a good one. Could be temperature. You need to put more energy into that snowpack, right? More, it needs to start melting sooner. Might need to melt a little bit faster. You can, so I would look at the long wave or the short wave radiation. And they, Adam Winstrel used to be in Idaho, now is in Switzerland. And he likes to give presentations where he calls snow modeling is just like working with an etch-a-sketch. And so basically what you do is you, how many people have ever like seen or played with an etch-a-sketch? Anybody? Is this my generation? Okay, you guys have seen etch-a-sketch, right? So you're on the etch-a-sketch and he says, okay, so you turn the first mob, you just get enough snowfall in there, right? You just got to turn the snowfall. Once you get the snowfall right, then you turn the other knobs so you make the snow melt it the right way. And that's the entire world of snow modeling. It's just the two sides of the etch-a-sketch, right? Put more mass in, less mass in, put more energy in, put less energy in. And generally, I start with the accumulation first and then try to tweak the melt after. Okay. Then the other thing just to be aware of is things that your model, you know, that no amount of tuning are going to get right. Here's some pictures, subsurface melt, does your model do this? We talked about with the ground heat flux that the 100 layer model actually did. However, this is actually like little bits of twigs peeking out through the snow, making it melt more. I don't know of any models that actually do that, right? Here's another picture of, again, sort of, you know, shallow snowpack with vegetation poking through. There, very few models actually get very shallow vegetation feedbacks correct. And so you need to think about there's a time where the processes you want to do just may not be in any model out there. And then you have to make the decision of, you know, do you want to build a new model that does this, or do you want to just be okay with not knowing this, which again is a value judgment. All right. Any questions? And apologies again that I can't hear you today. I will troubleshoot this more after class. Any questions? I know I went through a lot of things really quickly. I have some more model detective slides, but you don't need to see them all today. So I want to take a minute, make sure everybody is feeling comfortable with how you plot data, look at data, evaluate your model, and then go tweak your model if it doesn't look right. Everybody okay? I'm not sure if you... You guys even raise your hands. None of you can raise your hands in this world. Okay. All right. Well, then in 5 minutes, I will we'll talk a little bit about being a model detective. Before I get there, I'll remind you, because I got on my screen to make me remind you, remember just to reply to the discussion on Canvas, names of people in your group, your general topic for class Wednesday. Okay, this I will also give you the answer on Wednesday. Here is a hint from Matthew Sturm. I think I showed you this already once. This is my favorite. I just love this picture. His hint on what is going on here. And the hint is that this one is quite hard and it may not be strictly about snow. So think about that. All my audio working. I'm going to ask everybody for their best guess next time. So another thing, just whenever you're evaluating models, is that whenever remind yourself that you have to be Sherlock Holmes. You want to keep looking at things and you want to keep asking really hard questions. And whenever you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. And I am going to, in the interest of time, I'm going to jump ahead to case study two, because I know some of you have heard case study one before. So I'm going to jump ahead here. Okay. Because this is similar to what you were doing on your homework. So this is a case study of Sherlock Holmes. And this was, I was working with my students, Nick Wayne and Adam Mossman. Adam was an undergrad who was in charge of taking all the measurements and managing all the equipment. And Nick was running an early version of the SUMA model. And this is at our study site at Snoqualmie Pass, right in Washington. And we wanted to see if we were measuring everything as well as we could at Snoqualmie Pass, and we wanted to vet the model. And we kept finding that we were observing long wave radiation, and we were observing the surface temperature of the snowpack. And our modeled snow surface temperature could not get cold enough during clear, cold nights. And yes, it's true, there are clear, cold nights in Washington, even at Snoqualmie Pass. And so we were trying to figure out, like, well, what could it be? So the first one, Nick thought, well, maybe the thermal conductivity is wrong. We just aren't transferring. And we were running the model with 1,001 snow layers. So we had lots of snow layers. We thought we were okay with snow layers. And we thought maybe we just don't have thermal conductivity right. So Nick changed every type of thermal conductivity in the model. And he tweaked the parameters of those thermal conductivity choices. And you can see that they did a little bit, but some of them got a little bit colder than others. But the observations were still at least 10 degrees C too cold at night. We just were not getting it, and changing the thermal conductivity had a very small effect. So Nick thought and thought, and he said, well, okay, maybe we just got the turbulence flux all wrong. So he changed all the different turbulent flux parameters, and it did essentially nothing. Very, very small effect. That didn't get us anywhere. We didn't do very good. So we thought, we looked at the energy balance equation, right? We have the specific heat times the change in temperature at the surface is time. It's nighttime, right? So, okay, shortwave is zero. There's no wind. So we don't expect there to be any sensible or latent heat flux. It's very, very stable. There's no precip. It's clear and calm. And so what have we got left in our equation, right? So we started wondering, maybe, and we weren't doing any empirical things. We just had observed long wave. We're like, well, is there any way our observed long wave could be wrong? Because we're just, you know, we changed everything related to the internal heat. That didn't seem to do anything. We just can't get this cold enough at night, and we can't think of any other energy balance term that can do anything. So step one, we go and ask people who do radiation, and we don't know. We want to ask the radiation experts. And so after considerable discussion about how the radiometers were calibrated and debate about whether Kippenzone's calibration approach was correct, we were told by way of email, by the way, agreement or not with a model does not seem to me to be a good way to choose the correctness of a measurement. So they're basically telling us we better go fix our model. We had no reason to tell them that the long wave radiometer might be wrong. But we just couldn't figure out what else we could change in our model. Okay, if we wanted our model to be wrong because that would be easier to fix. And it seemed like the observed long wave just must be wrong. It didn't make sense. So we're lucky at the University of Washington. We have a place where they do black body calibration. So Adam, who was in charge of the field instrumentation, took it down off our weather tower and he brought it over. And he went, and there's a multiplier. So you get basically every type of instrument you get a millivolt signal. And the current millivolt multiplier was 73. And when he went and calibrated it, he got one that was quite a bit more, 123, to match in a black body chamber with a calibrated surface temperature. So we called up Kippenzonen, who gave us a radiometer. And And we started getting some really weird responses. Their engineer said, well, please remember that the pyrgeometer are calibrated against a hot plate and not outdoors. And a hot plate does not simulate the sky properly. And really you need a shaded and ventilated CGR4 to get any accurate data. And the manual contains that the specs are not quite right. This was an email dated August 27th, 2013. Just for price-wise, the instrument we had bought cost about $10,000. The instrument that he said we needed to get any value of use the CGR for is more like $50,000. And ours had been advertised as a fine equipment. So after that, about a span of 1 week later, we get an email from Campbell Scientific that says, we recently discovered the inaccuracy of all the programming examples in the CNR farm manual, that's what we had, and for the inaccuracy of the programs by shortcuts that we told you to use that apply incorrect multiplier to the sensors being measured, giving erroneous values. All right, so we were not so bad. Our observed long wave might just be wrong was a decent assumption. And 1 month later, Campbell released official radiometer program error to everybody who had bought one of these radiometers that the multiplier should have been 148. So here's the difference between the corrected observed long wave and the original observed long wave. And here's the difference in our observed snow surface temperature, the model with the corrected long wave coefficient, and the model with the original. And I think, yeah, the corrected with the original is actually, yeah, in the red here. Didn't work that day. It did. And somehow all the webcams went away too. Now I can't even see you. Webcams. Show webcams. Hello. There you all came back. All right. And that's the end of that story. And I feel like I'm talking to myself because I can't hear you guys, but at least I can see you. Does anybody have, if you have a question, raise your hand and I'll go look at the chat box. Otherwise, you just wave goodbye. Anybody have a question? Anything? Nope. All right. Watch your long wave radiometers. And if something comes up, what you're working on homework too, send me a note and I will see you guys in a couple of days.